Homeland Security got me, man. They're forcing me to make beer at Guantanamo.
Just give me a goddamn track, man.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, everyone in between, welcome back to Bossco's Beer House. Today, we're going to make something real simple. This is about as simple as an all grain is ever going to get. You're going to do it on a stovetop. You're going to do it with about 5 pounds of crushed British pale and 2 ounces of what I've chosen today is Northern Brewer Hops with an alpha acid of everything's approximate, about 8%. We have documentation. There's the recipe. Look it up on the website. It's called Fast and Cheap, just like me. And that's what we're going to do today on Uncle Bossco's Beer House. Stick around. So, to get started with this beautiful little recipe, you have to remember what we did on one of the first episodes, and that's clean everything and make sure it's sanitized. Your carboy that the beer is going to go into, your finished wart, as they say. To me, a wart is an anomaly on your finger that you use Freezone to get off. You're making beer. You need a funnel, a spoon, preferably a really big, bad-looking stainless steel one. And for the top of the carboy, a valve. As you saw before, I like using the More Beer silicone ones. Never had a problem with them. And as usual, for the cool down, you want the coil. The coil. So you want to sanitize that too. Toss all this stuff in your sanitization bucket. You got your carboy sanitized. We're ready to go. Let's make some beer. Next thing you're going to do is take 5 gallons of water. The simple rule of thumb for grain, if you're going to make all grain, rule of thumb. The rule of thumb is, you don't have to stress about it. You don't have to run a big, long calculation. Just keep thinking, maybe a little bit more water than the poundage you have for grain. Okay? Because when you boil that out, there's a chemical principle of dilution. There's a chemical principle of saturation of fluids. We'll cover that on a technical episode at some point. But just keep thinking, you got about 5 pounds of grain. You want about 5 gallons of water to start with, okay? That's all I'm saying. Okay, so we got the 5 gallons of water. I believe it was episode 1, I think, when we were actually brewing our first batch. I introduced you to the concept of steeping grains. Well, this is an all-grain brew, real cheap and simple. 5 pounds of British pale. All you got to do is go down to your local beer shop, get some of that beautiful malted grain, and have them grind it, because they usually have better grinders. This is what you're going to come out with. That's your grits. Now, this is called a single grain or a single malt. And like I said, it's going to be real cheap stovetop. What we're going to do is we're going to put this stuff in a bag I believe I have my bag right here. And what we're going to do is bring our water temperature up to anywhere from 160 to 170. Now I know that's a little bit higher than we did before, but what I want to do with the higher temperature, slightly higher temperature on these grains, is draw out more of the unfermentable sugars. So we have a natural, more of a natural malty flavor at the end of it. That's what you do. You want more fermentable sugars, you steep them a little longer at a slightly lower temperature, like around 150, 155 tops. So again, you want to create more unfermentable sugars so the yeast doesn't eat it all up, and you get a little bit more of that malty flavor. Go with a little bit higher temperature on your grains. Okay, so let's go ahead and bag these grains up and check our pot and see if we got a good temperature. Yeah, the reason you want the shop to grind those grains is they have a real grinder, and what you can probably get is close, but it'll more like chop them up. I'm doing this alone, so it's a little difficult. You'll also get a little bit of powder coming out of this stuff since it's in a net bag, and that's why I put the paper down. So I can collect all that, and since I paid for it, I might as well use it, because that's most of what the malt sugar is going to come out of, is all this stuff. Okay, before we go any farther, let me run down the recipe really, really quickly. Yeah, I'm working off a piece of paper. We got about 5 pounds of British pale malt. We're going to steep those for about 60 minutes at about 170. We have 2 ounces of Northern Brewer hops. We're going to take one of those ounces and add it at about the halfway point. There's a reason for that. There's also a reason we take the other ounce and add it near the end. And that's because if you leave the hops in there too long, all you're going to get is a lot of bitterness. Yeah, I'm not into bitterness. I want something that's easy to drink, nice and smooth. I'm going to be steeping a little bit more unfermentable sugars out of this to get the malt flavor, and I just want just enough hop flavor to balance it. Okay? You got to have balance. Everybody likes balance. But what we're going to do first is we're going to throw this bag of grain and steep it for 1 hour. Okay, and near the end, also don't ever forget Irish moss or whirl flock about 10 minutes near the end to boil. Okay, because that's what's going to coagulate all your proteins and all the solids and help them fall to the bottom. That's kind of important. You could do it without Irish moss or whirl flock, but your beer is going to be cloudy. You'll probably have to filter it, and let's face it, you want to drink beer, not chew it. Okay. Upon checking my boiling water, or boiling ammonia, or whatever the hell you want to use, use Clorox for all I care. You should probably use water though, because we're making beer. We're real close to 170 degrees, so we're going to switch this view over to the pot, and I'm going to show you how to put this thing in the pot, stretch it over, and what we have to do during this 60 minutes that we're going to be steeping this stuff is just kind of stir it around a little bit, make sure all of the grains get saturated and soaked through. Okay, so here we go, over to the pot. Back. We're at about 170 degrees by actual thermometer rating, and we're going to throw the bag in right now. So take your bag of grain, pop it right in there.
One thing you might want to do too is turn the heat down a little bit so you don't burn the bag. Because really all you want to do is maintain the temperature, not boil it, not keep it rising. So we're going to take this bag, since it's a nice flexible sock, we can stretch it around the edges here. Thanks, guys at Northern Brewer. That does not constitute an endorsement or product placement. Thank you. And you want to get as much of that up around that lid as possible, because you want to keep that grain off the bottom, more or less. And at this point, all you're doing is cooking grits. Now, you take that big, bad stainless steel spoon, and you get in there and you just stir that stuff around. And what you really want to make sure of is that all these balled up pieces of dough, you want to break all those up. And all you have to do for that is let them float to the surface and mash them against the side a little bit. Maybe that's why they call it mashing. Interesting. You want to check the temperature once in a while and keep it about 170 or whatever your target temperature is. So shove that right down in there. And we're going to take a look at this really quickly. And we are a little over 170, so we're a little over our target temperature. So what we want to do is turn this down a little bit. We don't have to have a constant flame. We just have to maintain the temperature for about an hour from now. So as you can see, we've got a pretty low temperature going with this giant pot on two burners. And even with that low temperature fire there, we can maintain approximately 170 degrees. So anytime you might need to adjust that, go ahead and adjust it. Check your temperature from time to time, and you're on your way. Remember, 1 hour. Follow the recipe. Here's another thing you can do to help everything mix and steep properly. I don't see anybody else doing this when they're doing all grain in a bag on a stovetop. It's something you can pull off if you don't have too much grain in your bag and you can lift a little bit. You just take this puppy off of here. Lift it up and just let it drain a little bit. Okay? Kind of like a tea bag. And pop it back in there, and kind of helps the process along, and I think it might actually help get a little bit more of those essential starches and convert them to sugars like you want them to. Only one of many ways. Okay, we're about halfway through this, and our temperature is being maintained very nicely. I've actually had to turn the fire off a couple of times. No problem, you're just maintaining temperature, not boiling yet. So we're doing okay.
Get out of here, it's just steepy.
Okay, folks, we're done with the steeping, and what we have to do now is get all this grain out of there. Luckily, it's in a bag. So my lovely and talented wife, Laura, come into the shot.
Okay.
There you go. Is gonna shove this tang into place when I pull the bag out. So what you need to do is just get this bag. Don't burn yourself, ouch, like I just did. See my video about my boiled arm. And that's how hot this stuff is, and especially with this kind of liquid in it, you really don't want to burn yourself. It gets like napalm, for those of you from the Vietnam era. And I'm going to lift this out of here. She's going to shove that into place, and we're just going to pop that bag into the strainer so I can maybe pour some cool water through it and help drain the rest of those sugars out. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
Let's go.
And we're up. I'm doing just fine. That's in place.
That's in place.
Thank you very much.
You should have.
And we are on. Thank you, Laura.
You're welcome.
Okay. Now that Laura has shoved this thing into place and we got the bag in the thing, it's a strainer, we're going to do a process called sparging. You've seen me do this before on other videos when we were doing partial grain or grain additions. And all you're doing is getting a little bit more out of this stuff and making sure it's all flushed out. You've got as much of that, of all that sugar that you want out of that, fermentable as well as the unfermentable stuff. And this process is called sparging. I don't know why. And as I've said before on another video, I think pretty much it was the first one, do not squeeze the bag. Don't try and squeeze anything out of it. Just let it drain. Because if you squeeze too much out of it, you're going to get a lot of yucky stuff you don't want. A lot of bitterness that's undesirable, and that's coming mainly from the husks of the grains. Okay, when you're done letting all this thing drain out, and there's not really much left to drain, grab this big bag of schmutz, drop it in a bucket, and take it down to your local farm or anybody that keeps animals. Animals love this stuff. It's cooked grain. They eat it up. It's great stuff. Barring that, set it into your compost. It makes great compost once it decays. Barring that, you just want to keep the raccoons out of your yard, stick it in your trash can right away and just get rid of it. That's where I'm going. Okay, you've seen this little toy before. This is the refractometer that we talked about in the little special technical episode that I did for you. So we're going to check the sugar on this schmutz. Notice how I use all the right technical terms. Oh, you pros crack me up. So put a little bit on there, and we're going to check this. I'm going to check this. You can't see it. Okay, so we've got a reading on the refractometer of about 8.25. So, on our refractometer chart, we got about 8.4 or something. And converting that to standard measurement, we've got 1.034 or thereabouts. So what we have to do now is start boiling this. Once we get it up to boil, that's the usual routine. See the other videos. I'm going to go ahead and show you when I'm adding the hops. And once this stuff boils down, that sugar reading will come up a little bit. And then we'll see where we stand from there, and see what we can do with the sugars to try and get a good 5-gallon batch out of this. So we're going to turn the heat on, and then we're going to start our boil. When it looks like it's boiling, we hit the clock. You'll see what happens.
Yeah, if you've ever wondered what a hop plant actually looks like, plenty of places on the web to go for that. But I've got a few growing in my backyard. We're going to be brewing some beer with those hops later next year, maybe. We've pretty much picked all the hops off of them so far, so they're kind of in decline. It's a seasonal plant. It dies back at the end of the year and then comes back. So, welcome to the hop garden. That's a strain called Magnum, primarily. Over here, there's all the little baby shoots coming out. And we've got several varieties growing back here. And this is the way I load them up. We put a lattice of string across two uprights and just let them climb as they like. And of course, the ones in the pots are just climbing the strings. Okay, so there's the hop garden. Hope you enjoyed the little tour through the hop garden. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we have a boil. Come here.
No, let go of it.
The beginning of a boil.
It's a boil.
So we'll set our clock up.
So we'll set our clock up to boil for an hour from right about now. By the way, if I haven't already yet, I'd like to recommend a couple of books to you. How to Brew by John Palmer. Great book, especially for your techno geeks who like to get
way stupid technical about your beer brewing when you don't have to.
But that's cool. Everybody's got their shtick. But John Palmer wrote a really good book, How to Brew. It's very simple stuff, very complex stuff. All the nuts and bolts that you didn't even know were there are probably in this book. Thank you, John Palmer. Another one especially for the home brewers, The Home Brewer's Recipe Guide by Higgins, Kilgore, and Hertling. Real great source book for good recipes. It's also a good source book to look through if you're curious about a particular style, because you can just do a little bit of studying. All happens up here, kids. Do a little bit of studying in the particular stuff that you want to brew, and then sit back and let your brain process all that and come up with your own recipe. But real good place to start, those two books. Okay, we're just about at the halfway point here in the boil, the actual boil. Okay, so we're gonna pop this puppy open. Northern Brewer. Alpha acids, 8. And because I don't want too much bitterness in my brew, that's why I'm adding 1 ounce in the middle of the boil. This is the first hop addition. Just like the first video.
Yum.
That sounded creepy, huh? Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to pull out, let me see. That's about half. Booyah! And we'll save the other half for later. What the hell? Let's put a little bit more in. Boy, if you've never worked with fresh hops, you need to work with fresh hops. World of difference between this and the pellets. Okay, so we're going to save this for later. First hop addition just went in. We're going to stir that up a little bit, let it sit. We'll be back in about a half hour. There's one person I'd like to thank in particular for giving me the idea to steep at slightly higher temperature to get more of that unfermentable sugar, to get that lip smack and malty flavor, a little bit more of that. And that's a friend of mine named Oliver. Used to brew quite a bit from what I understand. Still appreciates a really well done beer. Oliver, I owe you a beer.
Ha!
So we're getting pretty close to the end of the boil. And it's about time to add the rest of our hops. and our whirl flock to make sure we can get clear as possible beer. So, back to the boil pot. Okay, so we're about 10 minutes away from the end of the boil, so I'm going to go, this is when I had planned to add the second bunch of hop. Again, we're using Northern Brewer, about an 8% alpha acid content. Boom, there we go. Just that easy. Wow, do you really need to get technical to add hops? And our whirl flock. I like to break it up so it kind of dissolves a little bit better. And this is keeps the beer clear. Real simple. And there goes the whirl flock. Okay. So let's grab our spoon and give that a little turn. About 10 minutes from now or so, we're going to stop that boil, let it rest for a little while, and then we're going to throw our chiller in there and start cooling this stuff down. Yeah, we're going to put the cooling coil in right now. We got just a couple of minutes left till we have to kill the heat on this and stop the boil. And of course, we've gone over using the coil before. What you want to do is just pop it into the kettle and hook it up to the faucet, to the cold water side. Turn the cold water on and just let that run. Put the exhaust down the sink. It's really going to be hot for a while. And all you're trying to do is just cool off that fluid by running a cold coil through it. So we're just about at the end of the boil here, about 2 minutes to go. And after we turn the flame off, I'm going to actually just let this rest for about 5 minutes or so, and then we're going to turn the water on and get the cooling coil going and cool this schmutz down. That's what those technical terms like schmutz stuff. Okay, you've seen this before. We're just going to take what's in the pot, transfer it into the carboy. We're going to strain out as much as we can, because I just went ahead and added the live hops in there. And my lovely and talented wife is going to assist me. We're going to take all this schmutz and stick it in a bucket we have conveniently positioned here. Pretty much the same thing that you know already. And here we go. Ooh, that's a big pot. There we go.
This here took a while, so we all gonna skip ahead a little bit on this one.
Okay, so at this point, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a little sample of that, check the sugar level, and if I have to bump it up a little bit to reach that 3.0 or so level that I need to do, I will do that. Okay, at this point, you want to check the specific gravity of what you have right now. Okay, so we can check it after it's been diluted and then maybe add a little bit of sugars to help it ferment if it comes up a little shy. So I want to check this right now, so I'm going to take the thief. You know the drill. Grab a little bit out of there, put it in something like this. There you go. And since we're working with a refractometer, we really don't need much. So let's check this. So my refractometer, I'm getting a reading of about 11 bricks, And on the specific gravity scale, that's about 1.045, or what I would call just 45. Why do you need the extra numbers? Okay, so let's add some water to this because we want a 5-gallon batch and then see where we end up. So you keep a gallon of water in the refrigerator because you might want to cool that down a little bit too. By the way, and you should know, and I probably showed you before, whenever you add water to this stuff, before you check the specific gravity again, you really need to mix it. Okay, so we're going to do the swirly thing here. And that's why it's handy to have these things on little trolleys. Let me show you that. So this little trolley here that I've got this thing sitting on is on wheels. So it's real easy to do the mix. You should never, ever pick up a full glass cardboard.
Don't pick it up.
I don't care how strong you are. I don't care how nimble you are. At some point, you are going to drop it, and it's going to make a really big mess and probably hurt you really bad. So don't ever pick one of these things up full. Okay, so we've mixed it up. We've got about 4 1/4 gallons. Let's check the specific gravity again. We have checked the numbers. So, with about 4 1/4 gallons in here, without adding any sugar, which I really don't want to, we have about what comes out on the refractometer, about 8 1/4 bricks. That comes out to about 1.033 specific gravity. Or, like I said, why waste the wordage? It's 33. If we stop right now, add the yeast, and it ferments this stuff all the way down to about 1.012, or as I would say, 12, we'll come out with something just under 3%. The perfect drink and brew for a sunny afternoon. So the yeast I've chosen for this is Nottingham Ale yeast. Let me give you a good shot of that. It's a dry ale yeast, and so it needs to be what's called activated. So we're going to put this in a sterilized container with a little bit of warm water, and we're going to watch them grow. Or at least activate. You can tell when yeast is activating when it starts bubbling and foaming. That means these bugs are alive and they're ready to go to work. So let me get my beaker ready and then I'll show you what to do with this stuff. Alright, let's take our bag of yeast. It could actually be any dry yeast, doesn't have to be this. I'm making ale, so I'm using an ale yeast. Anyway, what you're going to do is get a clean beaker, sterilized, warm water, room temperature, about 80 or 90. And then the directions are always on the back of the pack, by the way. You just open up your beaker, pour these little guys in there, and what they'll start doing is waking up. Once they hit the beer, then they'll start feeding. But pour them in there, swirl them around, and this is just going to start waking them up. We'll see a little bit of action here in a few seconds. Okay, we've waited a few minutes, and if you can see inside there's some foam starting to happen. That means these bugs are alive and they're working. Time to pitch this yeast. All right, the next beer steps up to the plate, and here he goes. He's got the yeast. You think that beer stands a chance, Matt? I don't know, Matt. Top is coming off, and the wind-up, and there's the pitch. It's go. Oh, he's missing a little on the side. I don't know, Matt. Looks pretty good. There he goes, and there's the pitch. The beer didn't stand a chance. No, it didn't, Matt. He's even being nice to the beer right there. He doesn't have to do that. And he's swirling it around. What a buddy. Ah, what a pitch. What a pitch. So, another successful batch, I think. It's in the fermenter. It's going to take a couple of weeks to set up, and when it does, we'll let you see it. Thanks for coming to Uncle Bossco's Beer House. Next time you see me, we may have a special guest, and we're going to be doing a Pilsner, a basic stovetop Pilsner. All right. Hit it, Uncle B.
Just give me a goddamn track, man.